takes both men on. Hard chop to the head of Knodel. Takes El Slaughter down. Goes right back to Knodel. He has to carry the battle. And this is some battle for the world's tag team championship. Whips both men together.
Hey, when you get these four men in action in the ring at the same time, you've really got action. And right here, look at Rick Steamboat, Jay Youngblood. They're taking it to the World Tag Team Champions. And right now, Youngblood with that war dance.
That's right. He's ready to go. This is for all the marbles, the World Tag Team Championship. Switch down. Try to clothesline. Jay clotheslines Knodel. Knocks him down. Now you see, he signals. He wants that Cobra Clutch. He's been working on it. He's ready for him. He sets Knodel up. He's got him. Got him in position. He's getting ready for it. He hooks it in. He's got it locked. It's locked.
And fans, a little later on in the program, you're going to see the conclusion of that match for the World Tag Team Championship. Jay Youngblood, Rick Steamboat against Don Knodel and Sergeant Slaughter, the world champions. We'll have that match a little later on. Plus, we've got outstanding matches for the entire hour for you. Right now, Sir Oliver Humperdinck, and I understand that you have asked for this time. You have something you want to say.
I am the man that nobody expected to see here in the Mid-Atlantic area again. Jimmy Valiant went around and told everybody that he run me out of town. Well, let me tell you one thing, Jimmy Valiant. You got rid of Ivan Koloff. You forced him to leave the area. Joe LaDuke is flat on his back still in a hospital in Atlanta, Georgia. And you stole $5,000 from the one-man gang. And on top of all that, he put 17 stitches through my scalp. You can see them. They're right there. I was flat on my back in a hospital for 10 days. And Jimmy Valiant, if you think I'm going to forget, if you think I'm going to forgive, you're very sadly mistaken. Now, this is what I want from Jimmy Valiant. He stole my money. He's beat me up. I want a match with Jimmy Valiant. It could be right here on your TV show today. It doesn't matter to me, but I want a match with Jimmy Valiant where I got a fair chance. I'm not saying any more than that. I want to meet the man face to face and see just how tough he really is. He's real good when he goes sneaking around, grabbing me from the ring post. I can't even go to the ring with my men anymore. But Jimmy Valiant, there's going to be a day and there's going to be a way when I get an even break and I get you in that ring. I'll do it right here. It doesn't matter to me. It could be right here on TV.
Sir Oliver Humperdinck fans, and we'll be back. We'll see Jack Briscoe in action right after this timeout. That's right here, Jerry Briscoe, Jerry Dick Slater, Dory Funk. They're still here, and they're still creating quite a stir.
Well, they are. Those two men, anywhere they go around the world, they create a stir. And Slater and Funk, you're going to have to pay for your mistakes.
All right. And fans, we're going to watch Jerry's brother, Jack Briscoe, in action in a ring right now in a match against Rick Harris. And, Jerry, I tell you, it's always fabulous to see Jack, or you, as a matter of fact, in that ring. I think you do wrestle very similar in the ring. You look a lot alike up there, but the fans all around the area have just taken you two fellas right to heart, and they love to see you in action.
Well, thank you very much, Bob. You know, it's always a pleasure to come out and watch Jack Briscoe wrestle. He's my brother, and I'm really proud of him. You know, there's a lot of people around the Mid-Atlantic area proud of him. He obtained the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Championship, something that a lot of people said that he wasn't going to do. He came out and he won it. It was very special to him, that Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Championship. And he'd planned on keeping that for a long time. He'd met and defeated just about everybody that came along. Paul Jones tried everything he could to defeat Jack Briscoe to regain that title, Bob, but he just couldn't do it. Then along comes Dory Funk offering all this big money.
That's right.
Then all of a sudden, Jones's mind, the leech that he is, started clicking in. He says, well, I'm going to buy this man. Now, it took two of them. Paul Jones couldn't do it by himself, so he bought Dory Funk Jr., and now Dory Funk Jr. is the Mid-Atlantic champion. As you see here, Jack trying for that outside switch. He is back in shape. He's going to meet Jones or Funk, either one, and defeat him and regain his championship. But he's up there right now against a big, big man, and that's Ricky Harris.
Harris is a big one, and he's a strong, rough individual. Talking about outstanding stars we're going to be seeing during this hour. We mentioned Slater and Dory Funk. We'll be seeing them in action, fans. Plus, you're going to see Terry Funk and Golden Boy Jay Gray in a match, in a bunkhouse match. And that's where there's really no rules in a match like that, Jerry. Just about everything does go. Also, don't forget, we're going to see the conclusion of that World Championship match with Rick Steamboat and Jay Youngblood against Sergeant Slaughter and Don Knodel. And by the way, you were talking about some of the things earlier and some of the guys around. There's a new manager in the area, and let me tell you, it is not Paul Jones.
Well, I know exactly who you're talking about, and Sir Oliver Humperdinck. You know, he's been around. He disappeared for a while. I think he's been around the world trying to buy some new wrestlers. And I see his nose in here, but I don't see any new wrestlers around.
That's right. As a matter of fact, some of them that he had had before are not around.
No, they're not around. Right.
That's right. All right, Jack now is back in the corner by the big one, Harris, who is a big, strong, rough, tough individual. When he gets that shoulder in and all that weight behind you, man, you can just see the air go right out of Jack, Jerry.
Well, there's at least 320 pounds up there jamming his shoulder in there, heavy into Jack's midsection in there. And, Bob, when you get hit right in there, it takes a lot of courage to stand up or even let alone stay in the ring. And Jack has got that fighting spirit. He's always had it. As a world champion, he had it. As a Mid-Atlantic heavyweight champion, he had it. He's not finished, as you see. A great left hook coming right off. He's well known around the world for that left hook. There he puts it in, knocks that 320-pounder right to the mat with it.
He really hits the mat, doesn't
he? He does.
And well, that one lifted him right off of the floor.
Oh, he did. He had a good hold on him. He had a hold of that hair. When he swung, he hit him upside the head. There he went. Here you see Jack dropping that knee right across his chest, going into what made Jack the world's champion. The figure four leg lock right there.
Yeah, when you get that in, and unless you can get some help, there's no way a man's going to get out of that figure four.
I hadn't seen many get out of it or reverse it, and I believe that's it, Bob, for the count.
All right. Jack Briscoe with a figure four defeating Rick Harris. And right here in slow motion, watch him as he puts that figure four on, really applies the pressure. The winner, Jack Briscoe, will be back. We'll have more action. Don't forget the conclusion of that world championship match coming up later. All right, fans, there you're seeing the ring. Paul Jones right here with me. Paul, looks like we got a problem up there. Mike Rotundo is all by himself, and we got Dick Slater
sure
and Dory Funk across the ring in the corner. And right now, here comes Mike Rotundo over. Mike, right here, you're supposed to have a partner up there.
Could you move out of the way for a second?
No, you don't tell me to move nowhere. What's your problem? You tell them that's what your problem. Don't pay attention to me.
I don't have any problem with you, Jones.
Rotundo, it looks like to me that you're having a hard time finding a partner. Those two well-oiled machines up there, Dory Funk Jr. and Dick Slater, are ready to wrestle.
I'd like to apologize to you and the people here. I don't have a partner for tonight. The reason being, I don't know. I don't know where my partner is. It's supposed to be Tommy Gilbert. I don't know why he's not here.
I tell you, your problem, nobody wants to be your partner, Rotundo.
And I don't think that's the problem at all, Jones. I don't think that's the problem at all.
Hold it. You want to wrestle somebody? I'll settle this whole thing. Get in there and wrestle Dory Funk Jr.
Yeah.
Or get in there and wrestle me. But you better wrestle somebody because you're wasting my time and wasting these people's time and wasting Paul Jones's time. Well, get in there and wrestle. Get in there and do something.
Well, that's right.
I can't help it. My partner's not here.
That's right, Mike.
There's two of them, and I can't help it. Like I said before, my partner, Tommy Gilbert,
can't help a lot of things, punk. You can't help that you're not a man. They just offered
you
a challenge here.
I'm not a man, Jones.
Listen, they just offered you a challenge right now, a challenge to get in a ring and wrestle what up?
All right, here goes.
Are you a boy or a man?
Takes off that TV championship belt. Dory Funk is in at the belt. And Paul, good hip toss right there by Rotundo. This young man with a tremendous body, a lot of athletic skill and ability, a tremendous amount of wrestling ability and knowledge also, Paul.
Well, that's right. I couldn't have put it in better words. Dory Funk is everything you said he
is. And I'm talking about Rotundo. And let's tell you something, it worries me right now. Dick Slater is still here and right there ringside. And I don't think that bodes any goodwill for Mike Rotundo. I think Slater ought to leave. And Funk hits him that hard.
One thing you have to say for Funk and Slater, they signed to wrestle a tag match, and they're here to wrestle. And I can't help it. Like I said a while ago, if Rotundo can't find anybody that wants to be his partner, I wouldn't want to be Rotundo's partner either because, you know, I like to surround myself around winners. And Dory Funk and Dick Slater are definitely winners, Bob. Everybody supports winners, not losers.
It's got to be a distraction to Mike Rotundo for Dick Slater to be doing like he's doing, up on the apron of the ring, walking around the ring.
I don't think he's sharp enough.
And he made a tag.
Oh, hey, beautiful tag. Okay.
See, no way two men should go against one man like that, Paul.
It's a tag
match.
They signed a tag match.
They didn't bother Rotundo. He went right to work on Slater. Slater with a foot in the headbutt. One man can't take on two like that, Paul.
That's supposed to be a tag
match. It's an unfair disadvantage to Mike Rotundo. And that shows you, I think, what kind of guys your men are.
The people expect to see a tag match. That's exactly what they're seeing, a tag match, Bob.
All right, Slater with a tag. And double team now, Rotundo. Two elbows right to the back of the head. And Funk now picks him up, slams him to the mat.
You know, Bob, there's a prime example right there. A boy Slater trying to do a man's job. It's a legal tag, Bob, legal tag.
Two men against one, fans. Mike Rotundo all by himself. And Dick Slater and Dory Funk Jr., both of them taking on Rotundo.
Ooh.
Two hard right hands simultaneously. Look at that tremendous uppercut.
Doesn't look too good for Rotundo at this point right here.
Paul, look at that.
A legal tag. Another legal tag.
Yeah, but it's still two men against one. No way two men should be in against one. Slater now, Rotundo right in the air for the suplex.
Beautiful suplex. Beautiful. This should be it right here.
Now with a knee, just right across the throat.
The chin, right across the chin, Bob. Another legal tag.
Another tag. You're going to switch again. Boy, they keep switching on him and keep a different man in him all the time. Paul.
That's right. I stress time and time again.
Slater came out and Slater said, one of us will take you on. All of the fans
since I got involved,
all of the fans saw that.
Since I got involved with Dory Funk,
right,
I said, be sure.
Jerry Briscoe.
Interference.
He gets
interference.
And just pulls him back out of the mat. He pulls him out of the ring. Jerry Briscoe grabs Rotundo by the leg, pulls him out.
Briscoe is not supposed to be here. That is interference.
He's going to get in there with his clothes on. All right, Jerry Briscoe fans in the ring, cutting off Dory Funk Jr. from Mike Rotundo, shielding Rotundo. And now here's Rotundo into the ring as Slater gets him by the hair with the elbow smash.
Briscoe could be fined for this, for interfering in this tag match. He could be fined heavily.
Paul, he's just
this is
trying.
One thing that I've been stressing
he's
all along.
Trying to even things up a little bit.
He's not just supposed to be involved in this tag match.
We got a wild time right now. Three of them are in the ring. Funk now has Rotundo back into the ropes over near his corner. Off of the ropes, and Rotundo goes down from an elbow.
Bob, I'll straighten this out tomorrow, I guarantee you.
Kicking out is Rotundo. Pile driver. Oh,
beautiful pile driver.
Only a count of two, and again he kicks out.
Another legal tag.
Jerry Briscoe, who came charging in. Paul, he's playing right by the rules. He's outside the corner. He's waiting for Rotundo to come over. Hope he can get over to make a
if
tag.
If everybody knew the truth, Briscoe is just like his brother Jack. He's hoping that Rotundo will not tag him.
It's a tremendous show of friendship. And also, I think, good sportsmanship that he did it. And there's the tag. And here comes Jerry Briscoe. Slams Slater in, and the referee now is taking him out back out of the ring. A tag. Punk again now with a slam on Rotundo over the ropes and misses the elbow. Ducks under a right hand. Now let's see if he can make a tag. Trying to get to the corner. Here comes Slater, and he made it. Briscoe with a foot right into the midsection now of Slater. Jerry Briscoe, who came into the ring to give his friend a hand. Mike Rotundo, who had two men against him, Dory Funk Jr. and Dick Slater. It's been evened up a little bit now by Briscoe. There goes Rotundo out. Briscoe now double teamed. Now Slater outside of the ring. He's got Rotundo. The atomic drop outside of the ring on the concrete floor by Slater. But Briscoe's got that figure four on Funk. Slater slamming the headbutts now right into Briscoe. Being held there by Funk as Funk has got his legs holding him in the ring as they sling the referee aside. It's been a wild time. Referee Stu Schwartz ring that bell. They're both now
attacking. It looks like Jerry Briscoe at his match.
Look at Jack Briscoe.
His brother, Jack Briscoe. Paul Jones, Dory Funk Jr., Dick Slater all go flying out of the ring when Jack Briscoe comes charging in. And Slater and Funk have been disqualified. The winners on that disqualification are going to be Mike Rotundo and Jerry Briscoe. As you see a portion of that action in slow motion, and what action it was when it started out 2-1, then when it evened up, Funk and Slater really took off. Mike Rotundo and Jack Briscoe are winners on the disqualification. Fans right here ringside with us now, Mike Rotundo. And Mike, that really turned out to be a bad time for you.
Funk and Slater, you big mouth Slater, you cheap shot, you're going to pay for that. If it's the last thing I do in this area, you're both going to pay for that because I'm sick and tired of this crap you're taking on. You're coming in here and interfering. I didn't have a partner. I agreed to get in there and wrestle. Funk, one guy. They team up on me and do that kind of stuff. This old country boy ain't going to stand for it any longer.
I tell you another thing, Mike. You heard Paul Jones and the fans heard Paul Jones saying you didn't have a friend, you couldn't find anybody to wrestle with you. Boy, you got a friend in Jerry Briscoe.
That's why Paul Jones is out here sitting on and dressed up in a tuxedo because he doesn't have the guts to get in that ring and come on like a man. He called me. He said, you ain't a man, you ain't a punk, you're just a punk. I'll get Paul Jones, I'll get Dory Funk or Slater, any one of them in that ring. And I might be young and I might not know it all, but I'll give them anything they want in that ring right there.
What about the Briscoes, too? I mean, yeah, I tell you, Mike, you really owe them a lot.
I got to thank Jack and Gerald because if they weren't out here, if Gerald didn't come out, there's no telling what they could have done to me. They could have hurt me and crippled me for good. And I thank them very much. And that's the kind of men Jack and Jerry Briscoe are. They won't stand by and let that go by. So Funk, Slater, and Jones, you're going to pay for it. I don't care. And I know Jack and Gerald feel the same way. We're going to come after them.
But now
with Dory, everything we got.
Dory Funk Jr., Dick Slater. It's been this way with Slater now for several weeks. It's been this way with Funk, Mike. It's something that's just building. I think it's going to continue to build.
It's going to build until the top blows off. And I want to be right in the fire when it does. And I want to have my hands on each and every one of them guys. Because that's not right. The people saw it. And everyone out there on the TV saw it. That's not right. That's not right. This is a professional sport. We're paid athletes. We're paid athletes. That kind of stuff shouldn't go on. I don't know how to stop it, but it's going to stop. And if we have to get rough and dirty and get nasty like them, we're going to do that too.
Paul Jones now, evidently he's adding a lot to that, and he's going to make it even rougher for guys like you to pay back guys like Slater.
Paul Jones is an intelligent man, and he's also a cheap shot, and he's going to pay for that. He might have some intelligence and ability, but he sure doesn't show it the way he acts. And Jones, I'm never going to forget what you just did to me. Never.
All right, fans, that's it right here at ringside. As we have a tape of a match from Florida that we know you're really going to enjoy seeing. It's a bunkhouse rules match. And a bunkhouse rules match, anything goes. The match between Golden Boy Jay Gray and Terry Funk. What action? Let's watch it right here.
In full wrestling trunks, but Terry Funk out there, and of course he is in come as you are mode, just as if he had come in off the range. A bunkhouse match rules, which means basically anything goes, and Funk is proving that very quickly. If Jerry Gray wasn't aware of what he was in for, he is now. And you're dealing in Terry Funk's backyard. And Funk, the most volatile, explosive wrestler I've ever seen, now doing exactly that on Jerry Gray. Funk. Funk caught that time by Gray. Gray catches him again. And Funk, stunned, but that third time he got hit, it all seemed to come back together. And Funk now explodes on Gray. And Funk going absolutely berserk. And you can hear the crowd already picking up the chant about "We want Dustin." And a high vertical suplex by Terry Funk on Jerry Gray. And even though it's under bunkhouse rules, you notice that Funk has gone back to the basics, using that cowboy boot to his total advantage. Didn't allow the pin. Funk caught him with a boot. Gray is down. Has the count. And Terry Funk, no question about it, the master of the bunkhouse match, is victorious here.
Dick Slater, what you did up there to Mike Rotundo.
Oh, are you trying to tell me that I am a nasty individual? Are you trying to tell me that I am wrong for doing that to a young kid that comes out here,
absolutely,
tries to insult me, tries to insult Dory Funk Jr., and tries to insult Paul Jones? You think Gary Hart would stand for being insulted like that? No. Well, let me tell you something, Rotundo. You may be around this profession a very short time. You may be inexperienced. But you keep on messing with me, and you're going to be in professional wrestling a very, very short time. And another thing I'd like to say right now, Jerry Briscoe, there's only one great American hero in this world, and that is Dick Slater. I am the last surviving hero among all professional wrestlers. But Jerry Briscoe and Jack Briscoe, you bunch of stinking, drunken Indians, come out here and try to rescue some little guy that comes over here and pretends like he's a good athlete. That still reminds me of Piper, and I haven't seen Piper around in a little while. Where is Rodney Piper at? Where is your mouth, Piper? You know, I am involved in a lot of things around here. And
all right, the crowd.
I don't have to be insulted by anybody here. I'd like to say hello to Gary Hart, because Gary Hart and myself go back a long way. He's a man with a lot of class, and he's a man that's taken professional wrestling in his own pride. He's managed the greatest wrestlers that there's been in the ring.
Right here, fans. Gary Hart,
are you
manager
trying to cut
of the great
off
Kabuki.
Now?
I was just going to ask you, what in the world are you doing here?
Well, right now I'm having a little personal problem. The great Kabuki has been deported from the United States because of actions that they say were committed in the state of Texas. So therefore, I'm more or less out scouting the great talent, and there's no greater talent than right here in the Mid-Atlantic. And I'm here checking it out. May look to spend a few dollars. May want to purchase some contracts. May like to move my operations up into this area. Soon as I get the personal problems with the immigration settled with the great Kabuki, I can bring him back into this country. But until then, I am going to go to certain areas in wrestling that are dominant with leading contenders, and the Mid-Atlantic. They definitely have the leading contenders for Ric Flair's title. And I'm looking to spend some cash and maybe have a good time.
You're talking about talent. Boy, we've got the talent here. You've seen a little bit of it already during this
fabulous
program.
Fabulous talent in the Mid-Atlantic area. As I said before, I'm looking to spend some money. And I think the talent that I'm looking at here is not going to be cheap. So I'm going to have to get my checkbook ready, because I'm definitely interested.
All right, fans, Gary Hart here looking at the talent. We'll be back. We'll have more right after we take time out for this one. Fans, at the beginning of our program, you saw just a little bit of what was a tremendous match, a match for the World Tag Team Championship between Sergeant Slaughter, Don Kernodle, the World Tag Team Champions, Rick Steamboat, and Jay Youngblood. We said we'd have the conclusion of that match. What a match it was. Let's right now watch it.
He needs to make the tag. He does! Jay's in, comes across, hard chop to the head, takes on Sergeant, takes on both men now, chopping both. He has to carry the battle now.
Down goes Slaughter, and Slaughter and Kernodle slam together. Drop kick knocks Slaughter right out of the ring.
Jay chops Cronulla. Now he's ready. He's in his dance. Gets him up. Hard chop to the head.
Fans are going wild here.
Cronulla switches him. Tried the clothesline. No!
Jay, a clothesline of his own, David. A clothesline of his own.
Yes. Watch him.
Steve
he
Owen
comes
young,
in.
They're working hard on a hole like the Cobra.
It's exactly like the Cobra. He sets it in. He locks it. He's got it locked.
The noodle caught in the Sergeant Slaughter's Cobra hold. As Jay Youngblood, who we've seen before escape from Jim Nelson's Cobra clutch, has they got it on.
You see Slaughter yelling, no, no, he's got it locked in. It's tighter. Cronulla can't stand much more. He's going down. He's going down. Slaughter trying to get in the ring, trying to save his partner. He can't make it. Cronulla's going down, down on the mat. You can see Steamboat, he sees victory. Both of them, the world championship is at stake.
He may have his shoulders down.
Does he? Almost, he's almost out.
There's two. He's still got that little life left in that arm.
Oh, wait a minute!
Nowhere makes a save.
Now, Steve, all four men are in the ring. No, Steamboat's out. Jay now takes on the sergeant. Knocks him back into his corner. Steamboat comes in. All four men. Hard chop by Steamboat to Cronulla.
The referee trying to get somebody out of the ring as all four are going out. Here's Slaughter, Cronulla, both exiting the ring. Steamboat cuts them off.
They're trying to leave. Cronulla Sergeant trying to leave, but they won't let him. They won't let him. They're fighting.
Got them all
there
up. All four out there, David. Into the post goes the Sergeant.
All right, that match went on and on outside the ring. They're back in the ring now. Steamboat has Cronulla. Cronulla, his head is taking a beating.
Hard chop to the head of Cronulla. Here's the second referee in the ring trying to restore some order. Steamboat just charges at Cronulla with a double thrust. Here's the sergeant back in the ring. Down goes one referee.
Right. Law and order now. It's out of control. This whole match is out of control.
Slaughter into the post right there. Here's a chair in the ring. Steamboat with a chair on Cronulla's head. One on Slaughter.
Now you see, the referees, but you have two referees, they don't have control. Completely out of control now.
Cronulla pounding away at Jay's head. Jay throws a chop back. Unbelievable mayhem in the ring right here as all four men pound at each other. Two referee, one's already down. The bell has been rung.
They've rung the bell.
They're still going.
Steamboat
on Slaughter's head, another chop. Looks like all of men are lacerated. No way to stop it. The match, the bell has been rung. Steamboat over the top rope to the concrete floor. Out goes the referee. All law and order is gone.
Something has to be done. Something has to be done about this. All four men, they show no respect. The law and order, it has to be taken. We have to take place. Something has to be done about it.
Look at this. Both Cronulla and Slaughter down. They're wailing away at their foreheads. Here's a referee trying to do something. There's another referee trying to stop it. They're not going to stop. The bell has long since rang, and they still continue on. Look at Cronulla. He's on Jay Youngblood. Slaughter's head is cut.
They went outside the ring, inside out. Now we had to call the wrestlers in, John.
And they still cannot stop. The match, still no law and order is restored. They still want to go at each other. A wild, wild inning, and no wonder this is being called a bloodbath.
Let's be done. All right, they're fighting in and out. You see them back and forth, back and forth. There's
There's just no control. There has to be something done about both teams and the championship, because that's what is at stake, the World Heavyweight Championship. And Sandy Scott, like I said, the NWA has to do something, and I think you're here for that.
Well, David, the NWA board looked at this here piece of film that we just seen here, and certainly something has to be done about it, and they are going to do something about it. And I'd like to call in Canuto and Sarge over here. The conduct that you showed in this match and other matches that they've had, the NWA is going to levy a fine at you, and it's one of the biggest fines that the National Wrestling Alliance has ever given out.
Well, what about Steamboat and Youngblood? They were involved in this match. How about them getting fined?
Don't worry about them. Don't worry about them.
Well, I'd just like to say to you, Sandy Scott, you know, when I found out yesterday morning that you and the NWA Board of Representatives looked at the film and you got a hold of all the referees and all the promoters all over the country, and you said that we were going to be fined, and like you said, the biggest fine of all, I was very, very angry at that time with you, Sandy Scott, and the National Wrestling Alliance. But after I talked to my partner, Don Cornuto, and we spoke to our lawyer, we had decided to take the matter the way we should as gentlemen. We know what the fine was, and I have to say it was a big fine, and we just like to pay this fine to you, Sandy Scott, the National Wrestling Alliance. And with this fine, take this fine, take the check. We want to say to you, the National Wrestling Alliance, the wrestling fans, and especially Steamboat and Youngblood, that we're finished wrestling them. They're not going to get any more shots at this title. We're finished with them. That's it.
Thank you for your fine, but you will wrestle them one more time.
What are you talking about, wrestle them one more time? We've got commitments. We're supposed to be going to Japan. We're going all over the world to defend these titles. And we've got a great big vacation planned for ourselves in Hawaii, 3 weeks off in the sun, and we're not wrestling no Steamboat and no Youngblood anymore.
Well, you fulfill your commitments, but forget about your vacation, because you will be wrestling them one more time in a title match in March.
No way. We ain't wrestling nobody in March. We're on vacation in March, Sandy Scott. No way. And I told you before, we're not wrestling them. We're not wrestling them. We're the champions. We got something to say around here.
No matter what you say, you are going to wrestle them one more time for a title in March and in a cage.
No way. You don't put this in a cage. Sandy Scott, no.
Fans, right here, a couple of great stars we're going to be watching in action in just a few moments. Right here, Sweet Brown Sugar and his partner, and we're going to see in tag team action, Dizzy Hogan. Sugar, I tell you, you two fellas have been looking great in the action that we've seen you together.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Caudill. It's a pleasure to be here on the Mid-Atlantic Championship Wrestling Show with my partner, Mr. Dizzy Hogan. And as you can see, we're pretty good specimens of manhood.
Absolutely.
We train hard together, and I've had a lot of tag team partners, but I think Dizzy is coming along as one of the greatest I've ever been with. And like you see, their action right back here with Slaughter and Canoodle upset. I'm anxious to see what happens between them and Ricky Steamboat in a cage match. But in the very near future, any outcome, any tag team combination comes along, me and Mr. Hogan will be ready, sitting in the saddle, ready to ride.
Dizzy, I got to ask you, and Sugar, I want to hear your comments about this too. When you talk about tag teams, and a little earlier in the program, we had another example of that when we had two-on-one up there. We had Dick Slater and Dory Funk Jr. up there, and I know you two fellas saw what happened there.
Yeah, that's quite true, and you, in the back of your mind, you got to always keep that, you know, right there, and you got to be ready for something like that to happen at any time, you know, because Slater, Funk, and these guys, they seem to not going to stop at anything to get what they want and to get their titles and their championships. And so we got to be ready to fight fire with fire, if you know what I mean.
That's right. I tell you, and it keeps getting rougher. You know, Sugar, we saw Gary Hart, who is back now, says he's looking around. He's scouting the area. He's got a big checkbook. He wants to write a few checks, wants to get a few guys under his wing.
Well, you know, Mr. Caudill, if I came out here and told everybody in TV land what I thought about Mr. Hart, they turned this TV station into a garage. But in the meantime, going back to the situation we just saw a while ago where two-on-one where they were switching on and off on Mike, you know, the sport of professional wrestling wasn't meant to be a bed of roses. And as you saw, Mike hung in there. He had the stamina to keep from getting pinned, even though they were switching off on him, you know, and it takes a lot of stamina and endurance out of one man, you know, feeding two fresh guys on him like that. And Mike's to be commended. He did a good job, and we're behind you, Mike, 100%.
Dizzy, what about tag team wrestling? Are you enjoying that? Do you look forward to wrestling and having a partner in the corner with
you? I've been by myself wrestling for quite a while, and I'm really looking forward to wrestling with Sugar as my partner. To have somebody in my corner watching my back at all the time. It's a better feeling, than being by yourself.
Always sort of can look out after each other, I guess. That's it right here at ringside. There's Gary Hart right here, and earlier you heard Gary Hart say that he was here to scout and to look at the talent, so you're going to watch this tag team match with me, I take it.
I'm very interested in this tag team, especially this young boy, Dizzy Hogan. He's had a great reputation out on the West Coast, and also Sweet Brown Sugar up there. I'm very aware of both of these men, and I want to see how they fare. They're against a very, very good team, distinct different styles.
All right, and here's the Bell fans. That's Sweet Brown Sugar and Dizzy Hogan, partners in one corner. Ken Timms, Jim Dalton, which are a couple of roughhouse take-it-to-you guys across the ring. And the action right here, I'm sure, is going to be wild, because when you get two guys like Dalton and Timms teamed together, just about anything can happen. Do you think... you mentioned Sweet Brown Sugar and Dizzy Hogan, and I'm sure all of the fans know a little bit about Gary Hart and Gary Hart's background, and I do too, and I just don't think that Dizzy Hogan and Brown Sugar are the type of fellas that would sign a contract with a man like Gary Hart.
A lot of people said no one would elect Reagan president, but that come to pass, and I think a team like this, Dizzy Hogan and Brown Sugar, with the speed of the Brown Sugar and the strength and poise of this Dizzy Hogan, you'd be surprised what a few dollars would do in these hard times. You know, there is a depression in this country, and with a couple thousand dollars, you'd be surprised what people would do.
All right, and you're talking about a body. Here's the tag now. Sugar's going to come in, keep that wrist lock right now on Timms and take him down to the mat. That Hogan, and of course, Brown Sugar, too. They've got tremendous bodies on them, Gary. This young man, Dizzy Hogan, is just really a statue of an athlete. Big man, really well put together.
Well, if you hope to compete in the top echelon of wrestling, you have to work out very, very hard continuously in the gymnasium. You also have to spend a lot of time on the mat. But the thing that Dizzy Hogan and the Sweet Brown Sugar that I just picked up from standing here this short time, their brains, no one's been really teaching them anything about training their brains and their mind.
So with you sort of telling them what to do and sort of programming them, you think they would be even greater, huh?
Like in their mother's arms, brother. If they're with the Playboy, they don't have to worry about nothing but going to the gym and working out. Look at this Hogan. He's squeezing that man's head. You see, when you grab a man's head like that, you start bringing it up and down like that. You sort of shake the brain a little bit inside. Now, if he was real smart, there, you see, well, he did exactly what I thought he was going to do.
Right down on the mat.
Maybe he has some few brains anyway. Maybe he's been watching me.
All right, Hogan now, again, with a takedown. Chin, boy, he's got that knee right in the back of that neck, putting the pressure on it.
Dizzy Hogan's a very aggressive wrestler, and he is also a very mean wrestler. You can see the way he goes at a man.
All right, it was Timms who got a finger up in the eye, and that broke it up for a moment. Slam. Hogan into the corner, and here is Jim Dalton.
I'd like to see how this Dizzy Hogan can handle Jim Dalton, who is a seasoned professional.
Well, right into the corner, right out again, and now he's got that arm lock.
Dizzy Hogan's very impressive to me. He's got a lot of good moves for a young boy, and I think that with the right management, somebody like myself guiding him, I think that he could go to the very, very top in wrestling in a very short time. All he needs is someone that can handle business.
All right, and now here is Timms with the arm and a wrist. And they're keeping him over near their corner, too, Gary. And that's a thing that's going to work to their advantage.
That's the most important thing in tag team wrestling, is to tag in and out as often as you can. Keep a man as close to the corner as you can, so when you tag him, he don't have too much of a chance to get to the other corner. But I have a little bit of respect for this boy, Dizzy Hogan, and I don't think he's going to be an easy prey to these two boys.
All right, here's the tag. Now Timms is going to come back in after that tag from Dalton.
That is what Dizzy Hogan is lacking. See, he needs someone to enlighten him that he has a partner standing over in this corner. And the youth and the inexperience is the main problem.
Boy, Timms trying everything to get away, trying to get out of that wrist lock. No way. He goes right down to the mat.
This Dizzy Hogan is very, very strong.
You can tell that just by looking at those muscles that he's got there, Gary.
But you see, muscles aren't everything. Condition and endurance is a primary factor in wrestling. See, muscles are just pretty. But what you see in this Dizzy Hogan is endurance and conditioning, but his brain isn't working because he has sweet brown sugar over in this corner, and he's allowing himself to take punishment.
Yeah, that's right. He's been in for several minutes now and hasn't made a tag.
Well, the guy is very, very good, but he just needs a little advice, and apparently the brown sugar isn't smart enough to give that advice.
Hogan again now, fans, slammed to that turnbuckle.
You have to say one thing about this kid, Dizzy Hogan. He's got more guts than he has brains because he's just not going to give up.
He's really hanging in and hanging tough, no doubt. And finally made a tag. Now, right, here comes Sweet Brown Sugar in after that tag. High in the air for the headbutt. Fans, the conclusion and the end of the match that you saw for the World Tag Team Championship when you saw mayhem in the ring. Gary Hart, I know you saw that. That was a just a tremendous match and a wild match. And also the end of it, where the NWA has said that Sergeant Slaughter and Don Kernodle are going to wrestle Rick Steamboat and Jay Youngblood at least one more time. They're going to wrestle them. And I tell you, that's something I know the fans everywhere are going to be looking forward to.
Well, I could do a lot of good for Kernodle and his partner because, you see, my attorneys, that wouldn't happen. You see, I have an ability to overcome most obstacles, and I have found that there ain't too many attorneys that I know that is as good as my attorney in Chicago, Saul Leibowitz. He's a very wise man, and maybe I could help Slaughter and Kernodle just as a friendship, a show of good faith.
You mean you like to just help them get out of that contract and not get into the ring and wrestle? But they're wrestlers. They're professional wrestlers. They're champions, and they ought to have to defend the belt. If you're a champion, you ought to put the belt on the line.
But you should defend it at your own good time, not someone else's good time. Look at this Dizzy Hogan. Now, you see, that shows a quality wrestler. He went back to something that worked for him in the very beginning.
And again, Dalton right there got a finger up in the eye again.
Well, that's the whole thing. See, like I said, he's a young boy, but with the proper guidance, you are looking at a future champion right there in Dizzy Hogan. Believe me, and Gary Hart, don't say things like that lightly. You're looking at a boy that's going to become a world's champion someday.
All right, here's Timms now. He's beginning to maul him a little bit. Big hard right hand, and Hogan down on his knees. Elbow now right to the back of the neck, and this Timms is really going to work on him.
I've watched this Timms quite a bit. He's a pretty good competitor. He's wrestled a lot of the top names in wrestling, and he's showing that he's in there for a fight.
All right, Sweet Brown Sugar now back in after the tag. High in the air for the Atomic.
Very, very good maneuver. Now, if he finishes it up with some drop kicks, that's what he's famous for.
Caught him with a drop kick coming off of the rope.
No one throws drop kicks like Sweet Brown Sugar.
And a headbutt.
Would like to see the great Kabuki with any four of these.
The tag again now, and here is Hogan caught him in the air. Power slammed him.
It was a devastating power slam. You got a winner there in that Dizzy Hogan.
1, 2, 3, fans, as he put him to the mat. A good win for Sweet Brown Sugar and Dizzy Hogan. Watch it right here, the finish in slow motion with a power slam. Covered him with a press, hooked that leg. 1, 2, 3, and it's all over right there with your winners, Sweet Brown Sugar and Dizzy Hogan. Well, as we said, we had lots of action for you, and it's been a wild, exciting hour. We were going to try to get Rick Steamboat, Jay Youngblood out here. We wanted to talk to them about what happened and what happened with the World Tag Team Champion, Sergeant Slaughter, and Don Kernodle, and also what the NWA has told Slaughter and Kernodle that they got to do. And right here they are, Rick Steamboat, Jay Youngblood.
How you doing, Paul?
Rick, we saw it. The fans saw the film, and they saw what happened. And I can tell you, and I know, you two fellows are simply sick about it.
You know something, Bob, that's true, very, very true. Jason and myself, over the years that we've been tag team combination, have stood back and stood back behind our own wrestling abilities and used it in the ring. We understand that over the past couple months, the things have been turned around. The run-ins, the brawls that we've been having with Sergeant Slaughter and Don Kernodle. There's really no real explanation for this, other than the fact that we're trying to get those belts as hard as we can. We're trying to get them for the fans, and they're not letting us do it. And it just came out to, it just broke out into a big brawl.
All right, and right here behind me, you are our special representative for the NWA for this area, Sandy Scott. Sandy?
Well, Bob and Ricky and Jay, as you've seen by that film, that was a back alley brawl. That wasn't professional wrestling. And the NWA has slapped a fine on you fellas, and may I add, is one of the biggest fines ever in professional wrestling.
On these fellas here, too?
Yes.
We've been fined?
Yes.
We've been fined also.
Yes. We've been fined also.
That's right.
That's it. I'm sort of stunned by that, and we can't
have this going on. There has to be law and order, and if they want to get out of line like this, then we're going to hit them in the pocketbook.
I tell you, Sandy, that's a pretty tough blow. All right, now wait a minute. They've conferred over there.
How long do we have for this fine to be paid? I'm sure, like I said, it's the biggest one in NWA history. Well, how long do we have to, you know?
Well, we like it paid before the official signing of the match, which probably be next week.
1 week. One week. Jason, you know we're going to have to dig someplace to get some. From what we've heard of, some fines have been passed along in the past, and there have been some pretty heavy fines around this mid-Atlantic area, and getting involved with Nature Boy and a lot of other guys. And you just said told everybody out here that this is one of the biggest fines levied upon professional wrestlers today. And we got until next week. Okay, we'll cover it. No problem. We want this match with these guys. We'll cover that fine.
Ricky and Jay, you have one more match with them.
Right. A title match.
A title match in March.
All right.
Okay. In a cage.
In a cage. In a cage.
Title match, March, in a cage.
How did Sergeant Slaughter and Don Creed, they said okay to a cage match? Or you put their backs up against the wall for this thing, the NWA.
The four of yous are guaranteed a title match in March in a cage.
Oh, hot dog. Oh, we'll pay that fine.
Some way, somehow,
we're going to pay that cage match.
That's right.
For the championship.
All right.
Fans, that'll do it for this week, and we'll see you next week. And until then, so long for now.